सहनाववतु सहनौ भुनक्तु सह वीर्यङ्करवावहै तेजस्विनावधीतमस्तु मा विद्विषावहै ॐ शान्तिश्शान्तिश्शान्तिः
वेद वेद्ये परे पुंसि रामे दशरथात्मजे वेद प्रचेदसदसीत् साक्षाद् रामायण
मनोजवं मारुततुल्यवेगं जितेन्द्रियं बुद्धिमतां वरिष्ठं वातात्मजं वानरयूथमुख्यं श्रीरामदूतं शिरसा नमामि
मनोजवं मारुततुल्यवेगं वानरयूथमुख्यं श्रीरामदूतं शिरसानमामि
उल्लङ्घ्य सिन्धोः सलिलं सलीलम् यशोकवह्निं जनकात्मजायाः आदायते नैव ददाह लङ्कां नमामि तं प्राञ्जलिराञ्जनेयम्
उल्लङ्घ्य सिन्धो सलिलो सलिलो यशोकवन् जनकात्मजायाः आदाय तेनैव ददाहलङ्कां नमामि तौ प्राञ्जलिराजनेयं नमामि तम्
Today's will be the final installment of the Hanuman-Nataka lecture series. Thank you all for joining me on this journey. In our last lecture, we went over portions of Sundara Kanda, where we got a glimpse into Hanuman's unique place in our epic culture, his rare combination of virtues, his extraordinary strength, intelligence, maturity, and humility. In view of his exemplary qualities, unmatched by any other character in either Ramayana or Mahabharata, let alone any characters we come across in our own lives in the real world, it is only fitting to associate this exquisite collection of poems with Lord Hanuman. Thinking of him as we go through every verse in Hanuman-Nataka, by virtue of Brahmarakita Nyaya, some of Hanuman's impeccable character traits may rub off on us and leave a mark on our personality over time.
In the last lecture, we also looked at a Samasya Purana problem ending with the phrase Kriya Siddhis Sattve Bhavati Mahatam Nopakarane. Great accomplishments are founded on individual effort and talent and not on the tools or lucky breaks or any support system around the individual. We examined two solutions to the above puzzle provided by a husband and wife team seeking patronage at the royal court of Bhojaraja. In the same vein, I presented my own Samasya Purana challenge, Kimva Bhinna Madharmya Dhurtaka Vidau Trampesha Lankesha Yoho, for poets with a penchant for politics, inviting them to compare the Kalyana Gunas of our supreme leader Trampesha with those of the equally well-mannered Lankesha, the great monster Ravana. In today's section, Rama and Ravana come face to face with each other, mano a mano, for the final confrontation, a fight unto death. In the next few verses, we see Ravana trying to browbeat Rama, hoping to demoralize him before the fight. Stri matram nanutataka munisuto ramasa viprashuchihi maricho mruga eva bhiti bhavanam vali punarvanarah bhoka kutsthavikattha sevadharane virastvaya kojito dor garvastu tathapite yadi punah kodanda maropaya. Hey Rama, what do you think of your track record? Tataka that you killed was a mere woman. Strimatram nanutataka. Similarly, Munisuto Ramasa Viprashuchihi. Parashurama that you overcame was just a pious sage, a poor Brahmin. Maricho Mruga Eva. Maricha, whom you killed, was just a
beast of prey.
A harmless deer. Bhiti Bhavanam, an eternally paranoid creature, always terrified of its predators in the jungle. And then Vali Punar Vanaraha. Vali, whom you killed with stealth, is of course just a monkey. Bho kakutstha vikattase, O Rama, don't blabber about your meaningless victories of the past. Vada, rane virastvaya kochitaha. Tell me, which worthy adversary have you defeated in a battle? But now here you are, standing in front of the invincible Ravana, the real deal. Dhorgarvastu tathapite yadi punah kodanda maropaya. If you still have any courage left, take up the Kodanda bow and prepare for combat. The next poem is in a similar vein, comes from Uttara Ramacharita of Bhavabhuti. In this work, the following poem is rendered by Lava and Kusha later on in the story, where they encounter Rama in a battle and challenge him for a fight. We go over the poem here because it is similar in spirit to the previous exchange between Ravana and Rama, the same type of pre-combat demoralization banter. But coming from Lava and Kusha, this poem of verbal jabs at Rama and his brothers naturally has a charming character to it.
Vruddhaste hya vicharaniya charitas tishthantu hum vartatam sundastri damane pyakuntha yashaso loke mahanto hite yanetrini kuto mukhanyapi paranyasan kharayodane yadva kaushalam indra sunu nidhane tatrapya bhigyo janaha.
You old folks, senior citizens, what can I say? Vruddhaste hyavicharaniya charitaha. You could do anything you want and still we young folks are supposed to accept it and look upon your actions with a sense of awe.
Tishtantu, hum, vartatam.
All right, so be it. But on your resume right here, it says that you defeated the daughter of Sunda, meaning monstrous Tataka, of course.
Sundastri damane pyakunta yashasaha.
Shouldn't such an act of aggression over a female taint your reputation? We just don't get it. But let's move on.
Yadhitrini kuto mukanyapi paranyasan kharayodane.
Later on, during the encounter with Khara and Dushana, it seems you beat a retreat, taking 3 steps back. Now, is that something you can be proud of? Okay, let's drop it. How about your slaying of Vali, the son of Indra?
Yadva kaushalam indra sunu nidhane tatrapya vignyo janaha.
Wow, that was remarkably skillful. Did you not pretty much stab him on the back? It seems like you need a lot of creative PR to conjure you up as a hero. After all, Lava and Kusha had studied and memorized the whole of Valmiki Ramayana. So they knew the minute details of Rama's life better than Rama himself. That's how they were able to point out that Rama had taken 3 steps back during his fight with Kara and Dushana. In fact, Rama had to do so to keep his adversaries in the optimal firing range of his arrows and also to ensure that he had enough room to pull the bowstring all the way back. It wouldn't work too well if the targets of his arrows were too close to him. Like in the movie The Hunt for Red October. As you recall, the captain of the Russian attack ship shoots a missile at the Red October. But Sean Connery takes Red October so close to the attacking ship that the missiles don't have enough room to arm themselves because they're so close to their starting point, their source. And hence they fail to explode when they hit the Red October. Similarly, when Rama fires his arrows at a target but the target is too close to Rama,
the arrows,
Devastras, would not activate in order to prevent Rama from getting hurt from the explosion. So Rama made a strategic retreat to put enough space between himself and his target before launching his arrows. Similarly, Vali had the boon that he would automatically acquire half the power of any opponent facing him. So the only way to defeat him was to attack him from behind. In any case, it is amusing to see how Lava and Kusha managed to twist some intricate facts about Rama and use them to ridicule him prior to their battle. Coming back to the main story of Rama's encounter with Ravana, the next poem describes Ravana's declaration.
Re kala tvama kala labdha vibhava svairam sakamo bhava Shambho bhushaya nutanaishava shiro malyair nijangam muhuh
Kinchitvancha virincha sanchanu jagat sargaya bhijam kvachit Sannaddah karavala bhishana bhujo yuddhaya lankeshwarah O Lord of Death, you are about to receive an unexpected bounty. Akala labdha vibhava. Enjoy yourself. O Lord Shiva, you will have a fresh supply of skulls to wear around your neck. O Lord Brahma, prepare to seed the world with brand new creation. The world as we know it is about to be annihilated. For Ravana, the Lord of Lanka, is ready for battle with a scary sword in his hand. Karavala bhishana bhujo yuddhaya lankeshwaraha. Proceeding further, we have a verse in which Ravana proclaims the finality of the impending battle. Adyava janaki ramam kamam pasyati mandire raneva daruno grudro madhuran adharan mama. Today, one of two things will happen. Either Sita will enjoy the pleasurable lips of Rama in her personal chambers, or the dreadful vultures will tear away the fleshy lips of Ravana, fallen lifeless in the battlefield. And next comes Rama's response to Ravana's battle cry. Re re nisha charapate tvaritam gruhana banasanam tridasha darpaharam sharancha nirvapayami virahagnimamum priyaya mandodari taralanetra jala pravahaihi.
Re nisha charapate tvaditam grihana banasanam tridasha darpaharam sharam cha nirvapayami vidaha agnim amum priyaya mandodari taralane etra jalapravahai re 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 charapate tvaritam grihana nisha charapate tvaritam grihana varasanam tridasha dar paharam banasanam tridasha dar paharam sharam cha grihana tvaritam grihana nishaya charapate tvaritam grihana Vanasanam Tridasha Darpaharam Sharam Cha Nirvapayami Nirvapayami ಪ್ರಯಾಮಿ ವಿರಹಾಗ್ನಿಂ ವಿರಹಾಗ್ನಿಂ ವಿರಹ ಅಗ್ನಿಂ ಅಮುಂ ಪ್ರಿಯಾಯ ನಿರ್ವಾಪಯಾಮಿ ವಿರಹಾಗ್ನಿ ಮಮುಂ ಪ್ರಿಯಾಯ ಮಂದೋದರಿ ಸರಳ ನೇತ್ರ ಮಂದೋದರಿ ಸರಳ ನೇತ್ರ ಜಲಪ್ರವಾಹಿ ಜಲಪ್ರವಾಹಿ ಸರಳನೇತ್ರ ಜಲಪ್ರವಾಹಿ ಮಂದೋದರಿ ತರಳನೇತ್ರ ಜಲಪ್ರವಾಹಿ ನಿರ್ವಾಪಯಾಮಿ ವಿರಾಗ್ನಿ ಮಮುಂ ಪ್ರಿಯಾಯ ಮಂದೋದರಿ ತರಳ ನೇತ್ರ ಜಲಪ್ರವಾಹೈ ನಿಶಾಚರ ಪತೇ
Hey Ravana, quickly grab your bow and arrows, the weapons that have even put the gods to shame. I shall quench the fire of my beloved Sita's anguish with the rain of tears from the trembling eyes of your wife, Mandodari. Eventually, Ravana is killed and Mandodari laments.
Iha kalu vishamav purakritanam bhavatihi ಜಂತುಷು ಕರ್ಮಣಾಂ ವಿಪಾಕಃ ಶಿವ ಶಿರಸಿ ಶಿರಾಂಸಿ ಯಾನಿ ರೇಜುಹು ಶಿವ ಶಿವತ ಲುಟಂತಿ ಗೃಧ್ರಪಾದೈಹಿ ಇಹ ಖಲು ವಿಷಮ ಪುರಾಕೃತಾನಾಂ ವಿಷಮಃ ಪುರಾಕೃತಾನಾಂ ಇಹ ಖಲು ವಿಷಮ ಲುಟಂತಿ ಗೃಧ್ರಪಾದೈಹಿ Shiva Shivatani Lutanti Gridrapadaihi Shiva Shirasi Shiransi Arirajuhu Shiva Shirasi Shiransi Arirajuhu Shiva 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 Tani Lutanti Gridrapadaihi Lutanti Gridrapadaihi Shiva Shiva Tani Lutanti Gridrapadaihi
This poem was also introduced in the form of a Samasya Purana puzzle, where the second half is left to the imagination of a creative poet. Recall that according to legend, King Bhoja discovered the verses of Hanuman-Nataka on the rocks floating on the ocean in the southern shores of India. It is said that only the first half of the current shloka was visible on one of the rocks, while the remainder lay hidden underwater. So the visible portion was, Iha kalu vishamah purakrutanam bhavati hi jantushu karmanam vipakah. It is hard to predict when and how a man's karma catches up with him. A man's karma, as we say in this country. This particular verse, set in the semi-symmetric Pushpitagra poetic meter, was written on a boulder that was too hard to be lifted up so as to reveal the other half underneath. So, King Bhoja challenged his poets to guess the second half of the above verse based on their own imagination. In response, poet Kalidasa is said to have come up with the following second half. Shiva Shirasi Shiramsi Yani Rejuhu Shiva Shivatani Lutanti Gridrapade. So it describes Ravana's wife Mandodari lamenting over Ravana's demise. Once upon a time, these heads of Ravana lay glistening on top of Shiva's head as Ravana himself offered them in worship of Lord Shiva. As Ravana offered his own heads in worship of Lord Shiva. Alas, today the very same heads are getting crushed under the feet of common vultures. Indeed, it's hard to guess how a person's sins catch up with him eventually. It's a timeless cautionary tale for one and all. Moving on, here's a parody on Ravana's 10 heads, where a certain road Romeo pleads with his sweetheart.
Yushmat krute kanjala manjulakshi shiro madiyam yadi atiyatu nitani nasham janakatma jayai dashananena api dashananani.
Oh damsel with pretty eyes, if I am going to lose my head over you, so be it. After all, Ravana lost all 10 of his heads on account of Sita. So the next verse is another example of Samasya Purana. As usual, the last quarter of the verse is revealed by the challenger. Angara madhye jalajam vipati. A lotus is seen amidst the cinders, pieces of burnt coal. So how can there be a lotus in the midst of charcoal? The completion or the solution to the above puzzle is a verse describing Sita's agni pravesha.
Vahnim gataya janakatma jayaha Prapulla Rajiva Mukham Vilokya Uvacha Ramah Kimaho Suradin Angara Madhye Jalajam Vibhati.
When Sita entered the fire, he saw Sita's lotus face unscathed inside the fire. Unable to believe his eyes, Rama asked the gods assembled in the sky, "What is this? I see a lotus amidst the cinders. The rest of the wood is burning away, turning into ash, but Sita herself is unharmed, as evidenced by the image of her lotus face." And the next verse describes Rama's relief. This is from Kshemendra's Ramayana Manjari, also known as Ramakatha Manjari.
Tat satyam ramaniyanam swaste manasi ramyata acharu sukhinam charu charu dukkaya dukkinam.
In Hanuman Nataka, we have a slight variation.
Tatra Ramo Ratim Lebhe Napriya Virahardita
Tatsatyam Ramaniyanam Swaste Manasi Ramyata. At last, Rama's mind was at ease, as he was no longer tormented by his separation from Sita. It is true that when the mind is pleased, even ordinary things in the world appear to be pleasant. By contrast, when the mind is troubled, even beautiful things stress you out and bring you sadness. How we perceive the world around us is really determined by the state of our own mind. In the next verse is about Rama and Sita's return from Lanka, back to Bharatavarsha and eventually to Aryavarta on the Pushpaka Vimana. Kalidasa has devoted an entire sarga of Raghuvamsha to describe Rama's return flight, depicting the amazing scenery of the landscape as seen from above, from the sky. This has inspired other poets to elaborate on the same theme.
Here is an excellent description of this part of the story.
Drushtoyam saritam patif priyatama vaste sa setuh param kveti kveti muhur muhus sakutukam prushte param vismite atrasidayam atranatra kimiti vyagre nija preyasi vyavruttasya sudhani dissamabhavan mandasmita janaki. Rama says, look, can you see we are flying over the ocean? Sita asks, oh my dear, isn't this where you had the bridge constructed? But where is that bridge? Rama would show her repeatedly, look, here it is, here it is. But then Sita tried to look, the bridge is nowhere to be found. And Rama was dismayed. He would say, why can't you see it? Look, it's right here. And Sita would complain, but where? I see nothing. This went on for a while, but no matter how hard Sita looked, she could not see any signs of the bridge where Rama indicated. Now, can any of you in the audience guess what is going on? Why can't Sita see the bridge? Yes, Rama was able to see. But then Rama would not have been able to see it either. Any other explanations? Yes, Lakshmana would have seen it too. So here's a fine demonstration of the imaginative genius of classical Indian poetry. Wherever she tried to look in the ocean mistook her face for the moon, and that resulted in a high tide as the swells rose skyward, engulfing the bridge underneath it. Sita was never able to see the bridge, however hard she tried. So wherever she looked, the bridge would disappear from right under her nose. Now the last line of the verse explains the riddle. Vyavruttasya sudhanidis samabhavan mandasmita janaki. So at last, when Sita realized that her face was being mistaken for the moon by the waves on the ocean, a lovely smile flashed across her face, says the poet. So here the poet seems to imply that Rama's face did not resemble the moon as much as Sita's did.
Although
in many other poems, Rama's face is also compared to the moon. In any case, so the next few verses describe the greatness of Ramayana. Ramayana Prashamsa. The next shloka comes from Ballada Sena's Bhoja Prabandha.
Akarnam akarochesham vidhir brahmanda bhangadhihi shrutva rama katham ramyam naghurnayati kashiraha. This is the original form of the shloka from Bhoja Prabandha. In the Hanuman-Nataka version, the second line is changed as follows. Akarnam akarochesham vidhir brahmanda bhangadhihi gunanakarnya ramasya shirah kampabhayadiva. This clever shloka combines legend with science and offers an interesting insight. It says, Brahma had an uncanny foresight. He did not provide serpents with ears for a very good reason. Now, what might that reason be? Can anyone in the audience guess? Yes, we are looking for some poetic explanation. All right, here is the answer to the riddle. Brahma did not provide serpents with ears because he is a genius of cosmic proportions. Indeed, Lord Brahma, in his infinite wisdom, could predict that in the future, there would be the epic story of Ramayana. If any sentient living being were to listen to this amazing story, that person would surely nod in appreciation of Rama's virtues and his greatness. But just imagine, if the great serpent Adishesha, who carries the whole globe on his head, were to listen to the story of Ramayana and perchance nod, shake his head joyfully, what would be the plight of all of us poor earthlings? That's the reason snakes can't hear. What do you think of that? This kind of original creativity and poetic imagination can only be found in classical Indian literature. Next, we consider another clever shloka extolling the fame of Rama.
Rama Rama Mahavira Kevayam Gunavarnane Yatkirti Kamini Bhale Kasturi Tilakam Nabaha. O heroic Rama, who are we poets to sing about your greatness? If your greatness were to take the form of a woman, then the tiny dot Kasturi Tilakam on her forehead would span the whole firmament, the entire sky. When such a tiny speck of your fame, so to say, encompasses all of visible space, how could we possibly describe your fame in its entirety? So this is an excellent example of Atyukti Alankara, a form of hyperbole.
Along similar lines, Lakshmi stishtati te gehe vachi bhati saraswati kirtih kim kupita rama yena deshantarangata. O Rama, goddess Lakshmi, who represents wealth, resides in your house. Goddess Saraswati, who represents knowledge, resides in your speech. But why is it that goddess of fame, Kirti, has left you and is traveling from one country to another? She is all over the map. What's up with that? In other words, his fame has not remained local. It is spreading far and wide from country to country. Indeed, the point of this poem is that we would like Lakshmi, that is wealth, and Saraswati, knowledge, both to remain with us in our homes. But it is highly desirable that our fame is not confined within our household, but rather spreads far and wide, exploring the whole wide world as it were. And that is exactly what Rama has accomplished with his life's work. Next, we come to a similar idea in Abhinavagupta's Dhvanyaloka, where a visiting poet extols the greatness of a king.
Kim vruttantaih paragruhagataih kintu naham samarthah tushnim sthatum prakruti mukaro dakshinatya swabhavah gehe gehe vipanishu tatha chatvare pana goshtyam unmatteva bhramati bhavato vallabha kirtikanta.
This poem is set in the Mandakranta meter, characterized by the Chandolakshana. Mandakranta jaladi shadagaim bhornatau tad guru chet. The Mandakranta meter is well known from Kalidasa's poetic work, Meghaduta. The summary of the poem is as follows. The poet is saying,
I should probably mind my own business instead of talking about other people's dirty laundry.
Kim vruttantaih paragrahagataihi. But what can I do? Kintu prakruti mukharo dakshinatya swabhavah. You see, I am a South Indian and hence a blabbermouth by nature. Tushnim sthatum naham samarthah. So I just can't keep my mouth shut.
Anyways, this bimbo can be seen traipsing along from one house to another, making a scene at the town square, in the bars, roaming along the streets like a mad woman. You know, O king, I'm talking about your lady fame. In other words, the king's fame is spreading like a wildfire. Until the punchline at the very end, the reader is on the edge of his seat, unsure as to what kind of trouble this loose-mouthed poet is getting himself into. So an unorthodox way of talking about someone's fame. In the next couple of verses, we see the episode of Sita Parityaga, banishing of Sita to the forest upon public demand. The next verse, a fantastic one, is drawn from Kundamala Nataka of Dingnaga. Lakshmana is entrusted with the task of taking Sita in a most vulnerable condition deep into the jungle and without as much as a prior warning, leaving her in the middle of nowhere to fend for herself. In that context, Lakshmana says the following poignant words, bringing out the excruciating distress he was experiencing. Aryamaranyam vijane vimoktam shrotuncha tasyah paridevanani sukhena lanka samare mrutam mam ajivayan marutirapta vairaha. There's a variation. Vane vimoktum janakasya kanyam shrotuncha tasyah paridevanani sukhena lanka samare hatam mam ajivayan marutirapta vairaha. So he's saying, what fresh hell is this? I was happily dead back there in the war of Lanka. That stupid Hanuman had to bring me back to life, out of spite no doubt, so that I may now live through this horrible tragedy, subjecting honorable Sita to such hardship and humiliation. Oh Hanuman, I really hate you for this. Sukhena Lanka samare mrutam mam ajivayan maruti rapta vairaha. I was happily dead there to come back to life
only
to live through this nightmare. Heartrending indeed. Without the help of any figure of speech or any advanced poetic techniques, the exquisite rasa of Kavyanubhava sustained purely by its emotional intensity. It should be noted that Kalidasa has described this part of the story in a very soul-rending manner, devoting an entire sarga of his Raghuvamsa Mahakavya. So the next two verses describe the end of Rama's avatara. Yad bhagnam dhanurishwarasya samare yajjamadagnyo jitaha tyatvayena guror giravasumati setuh payodhau krutaha ekaikam dashakandarakshayakrato ramasya kimvarnyate daivam varnayayena sopi sahasanitah kathasheshatam. What extraordinary feats did Rama not accomplish? He broke the great bow of Lord Shiva. He defeated the invincible Parashurama, the son of Jamadagni. Upon his father's words, he unflinchingly gave up his right to the throne. He built a sturdy bridge over the ocean. He defeated the great monster Ravana. Need we say more? Yet, all that remains of Rama today is a story in the annals of time. Indeed, fate is all-powerful. In another sense, we can say Rama may not be alive today, but the body of his fame lives on. This is reminiscent of Kalidasa's words, Yashashareere bhavame dayaluhu.
When King Dilipa tells the hungry lion,
who wants to spare him and eat the calf Nandini instead. Dilipa tells the lion that instead of taking pity on his physical body, that is Dilipa's physical body, that the lion should redirect its kindness to his body of fame instead. After all, the physical body is ephemeral, while the fame is eternal. By letting him sacrifice his life to spare that of the calf Nandini under his protection, his fame will have acquired immortality. And body could never acquire immortality whether or not the lion decides to kill him. So, yashashareere bhavame dayaluhu. In the same way, all that is left of Rama today is his body of fame. Another verse highlighting the transience of material life comes up in the story of King Bhoja as described by Ballada Sena in his work Bhoja Prabandha. When Bhoja was a young boy, his evil uncle Munja usurps the throne and tries to have Bhoja killed by his trusted lieutenant Vatsaraja. When Vatsaraja asks the young Bhoja if he has any final wishes, Bhoja wastes no time moping, feeling sorry for himself. None of it. He simply asks him for a piece of paper on which he scribbles the following poem and requests that his uncle read the poem before executing the young Bhoja. Reading the poem written by the young prince, his uncle Munja realizes the errors of his ways and hands the kingdom over to Prince Bhoja. Here's the message young Bhoja sends his uncle. Mandhata cha mahipate krutayuga lankara bhuto gatah seturye namaho dadhau virachitah kwasau dashasyantakah anye chapi yudhishthira prabhrutayah yata divam bhupate नैकेनापि समं गता वसुमती मुञ्जत्वया यास्यति
मान्धाता च महीपतिः कृतयुग अलङ्कारभूतो गतः सेतुर्येन महोदधौ विरचितः क्वासौ दशास्यान्तकः अन्ये चापि युधिष्ठिरप्रभृतयः याता दिवं भूपदे नैकेनापि समं गता वसुमति मुञ्जत्वया यास्यति मुञ्जत्वयास्यति मान्धाता च मान्धाता च महीपतिः कृतयुग अलङ्कारभूतः अलङ्कारभूतः कृतयुग अलङ्कारभूतः महीपतिः कृतयुगालङ्कारभूतो गतः सेतुर्येन महोदधौ विरचितः सेतुर्येन महोदधौ विरचितः येन विरचितः क्वासौ दशास्यान्तकः दशास्य अन्तकः क्वासौ सेतुर्येन महोदधौ विरचितः क्वासौ दशास्यान्तकः अन्ये चापि युधिष्ठिरप्रभृतयः युधिष्ठिरप्रभृतयः याता दिवं भूपते दिवं याता भूपते न एकेनापि समं गता वसुमती भूपते न एकेनापि समं न एकेनापि समं गता वसुमती upate na ekenapi samam gata vasumati samam gata vasumati na ekenapi bhupate naye kenapi samam gata vasumati munjatvaya yasyati naye kenapi nai kenapi samam gata vasumati munjatvaya yasyati ekenapi naye kenapi samam gata vasumati samam gata vasumati munjatvaya tvaya tvaya yasyati tvaya yasyati munjatvaya yasyati munjatvaya yasyati
The son of Yavanashva, the famous king Mandhata, who is regarded as the very symbol, the poster boy of Krita Yuga, the age of virtue. Even that extraordinary virtuous personage did not get to enjoy his kingdom and wealth forever. So Mandhata was not only a virtuous king, he was virtuous compared to other kings of the Krita Yuga. In last week's lecture, we saw
Angada asking,
Krutam Kimu Yugam? Is Krita just the name of an epoch? It's an extraordinary one. So even in those extraordinary times, Mandhata had distinguished himself as a very virtuous king. Even that king did not acquire immortality. He had to relinquish his kingdom and move on to his afterlife without taking anything with him. The heroic person who built a bridge across an unruly ocean, he who overcame the ten-headed monster Ravana, Dashasyantaka, where is he now? Similarly, many other noble personalities like Yudhishthira, Nala, Harishchandra, Bhagiratha, the Shat Chakravartis or the six great emperors in all, when they eventually passed on, their kingdom and their wealth did not follow any one of them. Do you really believe you, Munja, will manage to take all this wealth with you in your afterlife? Do you think you will be the one who finally cracks the code? Reading this poem, his uncle Munja had a Jnanodaya and the rest is history. In a parallel depiction of Kumaravyasa in his composition on Mahabharata, Sri Krishna asked Duryodhana during the peace negotiation, Janapa kel arodane uriya haikidalu dharani vanite, meaning, O King Duryodhana, tell me, did the goddess of kingdom, Rajalakshmi, did she ever jump into the funeral pyre with her dear departed king? Obviously, never. Moving on.
Slightly different context. Kalidasa actually has a Janapashtanga or something like that. Raja, he laments and Moja dies.
Right. Oh, eventually he dies, of course, as everybody does.
Probably something like Moja is not, he does something and suddenly he is getting it without knowing and gets something like that.
You should watch Kaviratna Kalidasa. That story, Bhojaraja asks Kalidasa to compose his Charama Shloka or his eulogy that is rendered only upon one's death. Kalidasa refuses, but Bhojaraja spreads a rumor that he is actually dead. Upon hearing it, Kalidasa composes this eulogy, and his eulogy was so strong that when he recited the poem, Bhojaraja really had a heart attack and died. And then after Kalidasa realizes it, he writes another poem. The first poem is Adhyadhara Niradhara Niralamba Saraswati Pandita Khandita Sarve Bhojaraje Divangate. So the literature, the patronage for literature is in ruins now that Bhoja is dead, he says. And as a result of that shloka, Bhoja actually dies. And then he composes a compensatory shloka. Adhyadhara Sadadhara Sadalamba Saraswati Pandita Mandita Sarve Bhojaraje Bhuvangate. So upon reciting this shloka, Bhoja actually comes back to life. So it says in the movie. So that's the story. So his shlokas were so powerful that if he said something that hadn't happened, it would actually happen. Such as the power of his poetry, it is said. So that's the story of Bhojaraja. So the next poem is about immortality of a poet's fame. Not necessarily one particular poet, but good poets in general. This is a verse from Bhartruhari's Subhashitas. It says,
Jayantite sukrutinaha rasasiddhah kavishwarah nastitesham yashakaye jaramaranajam bhayam. The virtuous contributions of great poets who excel in the creation and exploration of rasa, the essence of aesthetic enjoyment, those timeless masterpieces will always be held in high esteem. The body of their fame need not fear either death or old age. No matter what happens to the poets, the body of their fame remains immortal. In other words, composing good poetry bestows you with immortality. In the Raghuvamsha Mahakavya of Kalidasa, the poet expresses a similar sentiment through the words of King Dilipa. Yashashare bhavame dayaluhu. When the lion tells King Dilipa that it is willing to spare him as long as the lion can be allowed to feed on the cow Nandini, King Dilipa tells the lion to take pity on his body of fame rather than on his corporeal body. After all, the physical body is subject to disintegration sooner or later. On the other hand, the body of his fame has a chance to remain eternal. In Buddhist philosophy or Jaina Shastra, there is the notion of an eternal dharmakaya, the body of one's righteous conduct, which is distinct from the associated putikaya, the physical body. Only the latter is mortal and subject to disintegration. While the above poem extols the merit of good poetry, the following verse by the poet Bhama examines the implications of bad poetry.
Nakavitvamadharmaya vyadhaye dandanayava kukavitvam param sakshan mruti rahur manishinaha.
Not creating poetry is not an unrighteous act. None of the Ten Commandments says, thou shalt compose poetry. Not writing any poetry doesn't make you sick. Nor will you be forced to pay a fine. You won't fall under a higher tax bracket. And you will never ever be stopped by a cop on the highway demanding to see your driver's license, registration, and any poetry you might have composed. But on the other hand, if you insist on composing and come up with bad poetry, you may suffer infamy that is worse than death. Indeed, kukavitvam param sakshan mrutirahur manishinaha. After this comic interlude, we finally come to a poem by Kshemendra, found in his work Ramayana Manjari.
Bhogarhe navayauvane pi vipine chirambaro raghavah.
Bhogarhe navayauvane pi vipine chirambaro raghavah. Navayauvane bhogarhe navayauvane. तत्राप्यस्य परेणदारहरणं क्लेशस्तदल्वेषणे क्लेशः तदल्वेषणे संप्राप्तापि संप्राप्तापि जनापवादरजसा त्यक्ता पुनर्जानकी यत्ता पुनर्जानकी सर्वं दुःखमिदं तदस्तु भवतां श्लाघ्यो विवेकोदयः श्लाघ्यो विवेकोदयः सर्वं दुःखमिदं दुःखमिदं सर्वं दुःखमिदं तदस्तु भवतां श्लाघ्यो विवेकोदयः.
In the prime of his youth, Rama had to give up wearing stylish designer clothes and also roaming around in palatial mansions and instead relegate himself to a desolate forest clad in rough bark garments. As if that weren't enough, he was robbed of his wife and had to undergo great hardship in her search. He had to ward off the dangers imposed by monsters such as Viradha, Kabandha, face invincible adversaries like Vali, had to compromise his principles and shoot him on the back. Wait patiently for Sugriva during the rainy season, hoping that he would stand by the promise made earlier. Implore the ocean to provide passage to Lanka for his army. Go on a prayopavesha, protest unto death until the god of ocean relented and acquiesced to his request. Not to mention taking on the Rakshasa army with invincible adversaries like Kumbhakarna, Indrajit, and the ten-headed Ravana himself. Even after getting Sita back momentarily after all this trouble, he had to give her up on account of public opinion. Life is full of such heartbreaking, relentless tragedies. Study of Ramayana should give us the much needed enlightenment and perspective as it pertains to our own lives. So in conclusion, a deep study of our epics and classical literature reveals the importance in our culture of inculcating human values and ideals as opposed to religious or political indoctrination. When we study fine literature, we experience aesthetic delight from a detached, dispassionate vantage point, from a third-person perspective, similar to the state of samadhi, mental equanimity. This leads to purification of our minds. Without such spiritual refinement, Dr. Ganesh asserts, no amount of philosophical study will bear any fruit whatsoever. It's akin to painting dirty clothes white rather than cleaning them, like boiling milk in a dirty pot, expecting something pure and healthy merely on account of boiling. To summarize, study of literature from a humanistic perspective is an invaluable first step in our spiritual journey towards higher levels of enlightenment. So that brings us to the conclusion of my lecture. I now call upon Medha to sing us a few songs.
Okay.
रामचन्द्रं भावयामि रघुकुलतिलकमुपेन्द्रं रामचन्द्रं भावयामि रघुकुलतिलकमुपेन्द्रं रामचन्द्रं भ bhavayami Raghukulatilakaupendram Ramachandram bhavayami Raghukulatilakaupendram Ramachandram bhavayami Bhumijanayakam Bhukti Mukti Dayakam Bhumijanayakam Bhukti Mukti Dayakam Bhumijanayakam Bhukti Mukti Dayakam Bhumijanayakam Bhukti Mukti Dayakam Nama Kirtana Tarakam Naravaram Gata Maikam Nama Kirtana Tarakam Naravaram Gata Maikam Samagama Dhani Sari Sari Dhani Dhamma Gari Sani Sasa Ri Sari Dhani Dhamma Magari Sani Samagama Magama Dhamma Dhani Dhani Sa Sari Sa Sani Dhani Dhamma Gari Sa Sani Dhamma Gari Samagama Magari Samagama Nidama Gamadani Saridama Dani Sarisani Nidama Gari Samama Gamadani Sa Nisa Magari Saridama Gari Samagama Damadani Dani Sa Mama Magari Sarisa Sa Sanidama Gamama Magari Sanirama Chandram Bhavayami Raghukulatilakaupendram Ramachandram Bhavayami Saketa Nagare Nivasanta Samrajya Prada Hanumantam Saketa Nagare Nivasanta Samrajya Prada Hanumantam Rakendu Vadanam Bhagavantam Ramaniya Kalyana Gunavantam Rakendu Vadanam Bhagavantam Ramaniya Kalyana Gunavantam Kakutstam Dhimantam Kamalaksham Shrimantam Nageshanutam Anantam Paraguru Guha Viharantam Kakutstam Dhimantam Kamalaksham Shrimantam Nageshanutam Anantam Paraguru Guha Viharantam Samagama Dhani Sari Sari Dhani Dhamma Gari Sani Sasa Risari Dhani Dhamma Magari Sani Samagama Magama Dhamma Dhani Dhani Sa Sari Sa Sani Dhani Dhamma Gari Sa Sani Dhamma Gari Samagama Magare samagamani damagamadani sanidamadani sa risani nidamagare sa samamagamadani sa nisamagare sanidamagare samagamadamadani danisa mama magare sanisa sa sanidamagamama magare saniramachan Prabhavayami Raghukulatilakaupendram Ramachandram Prabhavayami.
Wonderful. Really enjoyed it, Medha. Thank you very much.
With this, we conclude our discourse on Hanuman-Nataka. I would like to thank each and every one of you for your participation, as well as the encouragement and support throughout this lecture series. I hereby dedicate this work to the memory of my guru, late Vidwan Sri N.V. Anantaramaya, who induced in me a keen interest and passion for Sanskrit literature and the philosophy of Sanatana Dharma. Let's conclude with the Mangala Shloka. Swasti prajabhyah paripalayantam nyayena margena mahim mahishah go brahmanebhyah shubhamastu nityam lokas samasta sukhino bhavantu.
Sarve bhavantu sukhina sarve santu niramaya sarve bhadrani pashyantu ma kashchit dukhabhag bhavet om shanti shanti shanti
om shanti 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 Harihi Om Shri Gurubhyo Namaha. Harihi Om.
Akhanda Mandala Karam Vyaptam Yena Characharam Tatpadam Darshitam Yena Tatpadam darshitam yena tasmai shri gurave namaha. Vakti prajabhyah paripalayantam nyayena margena mahim mahishah Go Brahmane Bhyashuvamastu Nityam Loka Samastaha Sukhino Bhavantu.